many of you know how I got into food. Of course, I'm a musician, an artist, and a wellness enthusiast. And food happened by accident, even though I've been doing it for a long time. I was not planning to make it a business. And then I realized that this is one place where people consume your art. They literally consume your art. And there is hell of a lot more that goes into cooking apart from just using certain ingredients or following a recipe. Most of you will know why your mom's cooking is always the best, because she puts that much love in it. So for me, for cooking, that special ingredient is always remaining love. I don't cook if I'm not in a good mood. And even at my restaurants, I'll make sure that even my chefs are in a good mood, or they don't cook. They'll take a break. So today what I want to do is, it was an idea given by our country head, Mohit. He told me, I'm always grumbling at the chefs saying that you don't know how to use saffron. And so today's masterclass is going to be about how to use saffron, where you can use very little and get the maximum aroma, maximum color and maximum flavor out of this very little edible gold, as we call it. So I'm very happy to be here with Nitin, Khurafati Nitin. We just had a quick talk inside and kind of...
But aapne jo sab kuch bata diya hai na, those are all my questions. I don't know what to do now on stage.
I haven't told them what it is. I just told
Fantastic.
Them. So we are going to use the saffron topic as an excuse today to cook chole zaad for you.
Chole zaad?
Yeah,
chole zaad. That has nothing to do with Jay and Veeru.
No.
Wo chole mein the.
Actually, Shole was one movie I saw 16 times in Persian translated. Wow. I even did the Basanti dance, I remember, in school.
Wonderful. So what is Shole Zaad? What exactly is it?
Shole Zaad literally means yellow flame. Iranians claim that this recipe is over 5,000 years old. I know that it's thousands of years old. I don't know exactly how. It's one particular sweet dish that is has got a lot of cultural significance in Iran. They use it as, of course, as a dessert at the end of food, but they also use it for, many of you might be familiar when you do mannat, you know, when you make a request and you pray, and then, so it's a part of a lot of religious festivals. It's there at weddings, it would be there at funerals. So two sweet dishes, chole zaad and halwa, are the ones that are used at both occasions. But chole zaad in particular is the kind of a dish that you also use a lot when you have like a request, and then you feed everyone when your request is granted. So it's a very, for Nazr and Mandat.
Excellent. So time to make your notes. What are we going to put in it? Kya ingredients?
Alright, so the main ingredients in this are rice. We use Iranian rice. There is a fragrant rice, we call it khushbu kolokeli, which you also, those of you who know what I'm talking about. But in India, I use ambeen mohar, or I use this Bengali rice called govindo, because it has a lot of aroma. You can use, both of these come in smaller grains, like ambeen mohar is almost always broken, what you find in the market. But the aroma of the rice is very important. We also use a lot of saffron in it. Not a lot, but the little that we use, we take it a long way. I'll take you through that. We have sugar, and you have a little bit of butter. You have elaichi if you want to use that. Cinnamon is for the design on top, and as well as slivered badam and pistachios that we want to use.
And is that, that's regular sugar, right?
Yes, regular sugar. You can choose something else to put in it if you want. In Iran, we also have this thing called pan, which is sugar, but it is made of a kind of sugar beet. So it's harder, and the taste is slightly different, but it doesn't make that much of a difference. You can use both of them. Now, before what I have done is, I want to say a quick thank you to Chef Padwa at Taj Palace Hotel where I'm staying, because he was extremely gracious. He organized all these for me, as well as he allowed me to use his kitchen to half cook the rice for you, because it wouldn't. Now, this dish takes about 4 hours if you want to follow everything traditionally. We are doing a hack version today, so we are kind of a little bit compromising on the taste.
Or you can go home and come back, we'll still be here cooking.
So we have half cooked the rice over here. Where is my half cooked rice? right?
And it's looking beautiful. I want to see the rice.
There is also one more rice which was there. Could I have that as well?
Wait, chawal koi kha to nahi gaya?
Wo jo cook chawal rice tha na, wo bhi please ek dish mein tha, wo bhi please
dijiye. Yes, but ye to kacha hai jo.
ये कच्चा है, मैंने पका हुआ गाड़ी से
खिलाया.
अच्छा, इसके अंदर. हां, थैंक यू. सो नाउ आई वांट टू जस्ट टेल यू अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट सैफ्रन. शुड वी स्टार्ट कुकिंग और शुड वी टॉक अबाउट सैफ्रन फर्स्ट? हाउ मच ऑफ
लेट्स टॉक अबाउट सैफ्रन.
Okay. Now,
how to get the most out of
yes. Now, whenever I give a dish, a recipe to any of, you know, including our chefs or other people, and there's always saffron involved in Iranian cooking, and everybody says, "Oh, saffron is so expensive." And yes, I do understand they call it edible gold. Hello, thank you. Thank you so much. So the reason that we use it, a gram can go really far if you know how to use it. And to my utter surprise, many professional chefs don't. And in fact, I was on a panel just last week and we were talking about this, and one chef told me, oh, but every time I see Iranian ice cream or something, there are threads of saffron on it, because the argument was not to use it in thread form. And very sweetly, with a lot of love, I told him that's a show off on our behalf. We just use it for decoration, but that's not the way we use it in the food. So it's very, very important that you grind your saffron. Saffron is, even if you boil it in a full format, you still need 3 times more of the same thing. So it's you have to grind it. So you can grind it in many ways. I have got a stone grinder here. In at home in Iran, we don't use the grinder we use for saffron for anything else. So it remains for saffron and it stays covered. But you can use a grinder. And after you, so you need a lot of saffron to grind in a grinder, and then later on you can always use hot water in your grinder and use that water aside, so your saffron is not wasted.
And that's important. Use it only for saffron, warna lassan flavor aayega.
Yeah.
Just imagine garlic flavored saffron.
Yeah. So you need to, if you're using an electric grinder also, of course you've washed it and everything, and again you can use the water to, you know, remove the extra saffron. There is a hack you can use if you don't have a grinder. Now, some saffrons with some countries have a slight after bitter taste. If you put the grains in the middle of aluminium sheets and you use that to grind, it takes away the bitterness. But if you're using really good saffron, you won't need that. Now, saffron also comes in plastic containers. You can take a spoon. I don't have one here right now, but you can take a spoon and yes. So you use a metal spoon, and with the soft part, you just crush on the plastic slowly, slowly by hand if you don't have this. And even that really works well. Now, in certain climates, like in Bombay, it is very humid, so your saffron might get a little bit soggy. So you can microwave it in a malmal cloth for about 15 seconds, not more. I personally don't use microwave because I think it spoils the prana of the food. But if you want, you can. If you have soggy and like me, you don't want to use microwave, in your grinder add a little bit of coarse sugar. So that again helps it for you to grind it very well. Now, saffron can be brewed too. After you make it a powder, you need to use a brew. That again gets the best aroma out of it. You can make a cold brew or you can make a hot brew. So you can brew the saffron in hot water or you can brew it in ice.
And if you keep it in ice, of course it brews for a longer time.
No, it takes as much, about 10-15 minutes to brew as well. So what you do is you use your powdered saffron, you put it in a, I at home have a small little narrow glass jar because it looks really fancy, that's one for my saffron. So you put your grated saffron, about 1/4 of a teaspoon, very little, I don't know if you guys can see. Very little saffron powder. You put that in a glass jar and you take hot water, which you've just taken off boiling. Just 2-3 seconds you wait, so it's not immediately boiling. And you add about 1 or 2 tablespoons, depending to the consistency you want, into that in the glass jar. Cover it up for 10-15 minutes in somewhere like warmish and let it brew. That's if you're using a hot brew for a curry or a rice or anything. If you're doing a cold brew, you use the same thing. Again, I don't suggest any plastic containers. It's good that glass or porcelain you use. It makes a difference to it. So you put the same amount of saffron, a pinch, about 1/4 of a tablespoon, a teaspoon. And you put crushed ice is the best. You can use any ice, but crushed ice works best. and again you cover it, and as it melts on, either as long as it takes to melt or at least 10 minutes. And that is used in colder dishes, or you know, kind of
ice cream.
Like you are a pastry chef, so yeah. That is the way you could use it as well. So these are very, very, very simple things to do, and to my utter surprise, nobody does. So if you want to then later on have one or two strings, if you're doing something savory and you want to show off the saffron use in it, then you can do that. Now I want to say also, of course, do you know why it's so expensive? Saffron?
Because
you want to ask anyone if they want to.
Why is saffron expensive?
Does anybody know why saffron is so expensive? If we have a microphone with someone, so we can have some interaction, that would.
Does anyone know why saffron is expensive?
Or I'll tell you.
Because it's just it's in the middle of a flower, the stigma. Yeah.
So, the saffron flowers. This is beautiful, purplish with a tinge of. Yes, she does. But I need a microphone to ask. Can somebody go
can you
with
give
the microphone
bhai
sahab?
Hello, bhai sahab. Ek mic
so this audience. Chef coat, by the way, is in honor of Indonesian embassy. So I've got a little bit of Indonesian designs in it by my favorite designer, Salim Asghar Ali.
I just
came to know, I had this lovely time speaking to His Excellency and his wife, Indonesian ambassador. And he was mentioning to me that his mother is from Iran and she knows a lot about this. So he knew all these. She knows all the Iranian dishes. So may I know why, give us some ideas why saffron is so expensive. Please. Can I have the microphone on, please?
Is the mic on?
Shall we go there?
I think saffron came from very particular flowers.
Yes.
Which is the color of flowers, purple, actually.
Yes.
And it's maybe once a year we harvest, and it's very difficult to take the part of the flower. Saffron belongs on small part of the flower, and it has to be very careful to harvest.
Yes, absolutely. You're absolutely right.
And from one flower, you just have very little amount of saffron.
Yes. Thank you so much.
I think that's why it's expensive.
Thank you so much. It's absolutely correct. Absolutely correct, and you're right. So saffron is every purple flower of saffron has three stigmas. Just three.
Just three in one
Just
flower.
Three stigmas. It's about, say, 25 to 30 millimeters long.
So we have like 100 or 200 flowers here.
So it takes about roughly about 80,000 flowers for a pound of saffron.
80,000 flowers?
Yes, because it comes to about 250,000 stigmas out of those flowers. And they are always hand-picked, because there is no machine that can separate them. It's usually by women. In Iran, it's mostly given to elderly women. It's like a very... but in certain regions between... there was a gentleman here from Afghanistan, so they would know about this. There is a certain region between Afghanistan and Iran where they only allow young girls below 13 to pluck the saffron. It's a tradition for them. But in Iran, it's mostly elder ladies. It's a painstaking process. It's harvested in autumn, and it's not supposed to be picked in dawn, before it's fully opened up. So they feel that the smell and the aroma is much stronger when it's pulled up there. So that's why this edible gold is so expensive. And in Iran, you have many. There are different types of saffron. You have negin. Negin means a mounted jewel. And you have sargol.
Like say nagina.
Yes, negin and nagina, correct. And sargol, which means top of flowers, but sargol in Persian also means the preferred one. Like your Mumtaz Mahal was the Sargoli of Shah Jahan. So if you know like that, they will say this one is a Sargol, which means the most preferred one, but it means top of the flower. So those two are the very, and of course 90% of the saffron harvested in the world comes from Iran, and it's the best. And you have also very good saffron in Kashmir. But of course Iranian saffron, because of the climate, remains the best. So, if you guys have any questions about saffron, I can go on and on. But let's try and start with this. So, I'm going to start.
Can you do this on the rice?
Yes, please. So, what I have done over here, if we can have the camera shooting the rice, I have half cooked the rice. The measurement for that is 1 cup rice to 7 cup water. So what you need to do is you need to cook this on slow flame. It helps. Now, there are lots of steps that as restaurateurs or as, you know, home chefs, sometimes we skip. But they are, their traditional steps are for a reason, and they really do make a difference to your taste. So what you do is you cook your rice. I don't know if this is, thank you, Chef Vadhva. He's a rock star. He's done it exactly the way we wanted it. So you cook your rice. It looks almost cooked and there is no water. But what happens is after you add sugar in it, it becomes watery. So you need to make sure that you have got the water out of this as much as
you can. What rice have you used for it?
I don't know which he used it, but I...
But which one are the ones that we need
to use? Best one is Ambe Mohar or Govind Bol. Govind Bol. But any sweet flavored smelling rice is very good. Govind Bol, I think, is a Bengali one. So it's got a very, very...
Sounds
yes,
Bengali.
I can see her nodding her head.
You can't use jasmine rice for it.
You don't want to mix too many smells, even though I know as an Indian chef you love doing that. We love doing many things and make it stronger, but